Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Stand a little bit to this side so I don't hit the roof. Thank you very much. As you can tell, I don't speak British English, but I usually give my lectures actually in foreign languages, in different languages. The one language I haven't quite mastered yet is British English, and neither Scottish or an Irish brogue either, even though my grandfather came directly from Ireland to the United States. I think something as an introduction to myself, I was born into the pro-life movement. Both my parents were actively involved from the 1970s onwards. My mother is a medical doctor. My father was a PhD in philosophy. And we grew up with all these incredible, beautiful things going on in the pro-life movement. I'm from South Texas, a town by the name of Corpus Christi. So the body of Christ. And we like to kid around and say it's God's country. But it is, it's a very blessed place. And the people there, there's a strong mix. There's a very strong Hispanic population, Mexican-American. And for that reason, the church is very alive, very dynamic. And it's a large place. It's about 350,000 people. Metro Corpus Christi is about 500,000 people. And 2 years ago, the last abortion center closed its doors because of the pro-life activity. And it was an amazing, amazing thing. At one point, there were 7 abortion doctors that were plying their trade in Corpus Christi. And through years and years of patient and difficult work and standing outside of the clinics and getting involved in politics and getting involved in so many things, there was progress. And there was one by one of these abortionists who either converted or stopped doing abortions or left town because it was too difficult to live in Corpus Christi. and finally, you know, the culture was so pro-life that abortion was just no longer tolerated. And this is what we need to work for around the world. I mean, we don't need to make abortion illegal. We do need to do that. But we need to make it unthinkable, right? We need to make it something like racism or something like, you know, slavery, you know, I mean, just not just illegal, but unthinkable. Something that is not tolerable in a decent civilized society. And that's where you come in. I asked the organizers here today, you know, what message did you need to hear? What message does the SPUC Youth Conference, what do young people, I had a last talk, so in a sense I can send you forth. And they told me really that what they hope, what they want from this conference is not just that you will be informed, not just that you'll be entertained, the Kaylee was amazing, but you know, that you will take this as a mission, that you will see the pro-life work as your work, that you will unite with others. And, you know, I met my wife doing pro-life work, so something I heard earlier today, you know, that it's a good place for future, you know, to meet people. And it's true. I mean, you know, what better people are there than people who agree with you on the most fundamental things? You know, life is sacred. We have to defend life. We have to defend family. We have to defend marriage. And, you know, that begins at home. That really does begin at home. And the amazing strength and support they've had from my family is really what goes forward. And doing pro-life work is difficult. There's no getting around that. Pro-life work is hard. It's spiritually very difficult because you're going against the culture. You're facing people who are hostile, you know, and sometimes really hateful, you know, and you're put down and there's so many different obstacles that arise, you know, from doing pro-life work, that you need a strong spiritual base, you need a strong family base, really, to be able to move forward. And burnout is a real risk if you don't have that spiritual center, you know, and realize that we're all sinners, we're all making mistakes, you know, none of us is perfect. And I think the greatest obstacle, in many ways, to people going out and doing pro-life work, particularly on the street, right, is the fear that you're going to make a mistake. You know, and something you do wrong is going to have a terrible consequence. But of course, doing nothing is the worst mistake. We can't leave people where they are, and we have to go out. So I'm going to give you just a little bit of things. I've traveled around the world. Human Life International was founded as an international pro-life apostolate. And our founder, Father Paul Marx, was very clear about this. He said, you know, we, in a certain extent, have to make up for the errors of others. And because the United States of America has had such a tremendous role in promoting the culture of death all over the world, you know, and it does swing back and forth, right? I mean, sometimes we've had pro-life presidents, and sometimes we've had good situations, but by and large, population control, et cetera, came from the United States, and most of these bad organizations have huge U.S. bases, you know, and there's Bill and Melinda Gates, and there's Warren Buffett, and all these billionaires, et cetera, promoting bad things. So he felt the United States had a special mission, good people in the United States, to go out to the world and counteract that culture of death. And he was specifically kind of inspired by Jesus' words. You know, Jesus said, no man is a prophet in his own village. And even Jesus, when he was in his hometown in Nazareth, people went, oh, aren't you the carpenter's son, you know? and they just didn't want to listen to him. And he said there was so little faith that he could hardly perform any miracles. So in a way, it's good to go out to other cultures outside of our immediate area and bring the culture of life. So it's good to get involved internationally. And there are so many opportunities, right? The United Nations, different international events. But it's good to be involved, not just locally, but internationally, or, you know, outside of our local area. And when I go, for instance, to Africa, or I go to the Far East, you know, and people know that I've traveled thousands and thousands of miles to bring this message, they're like, wow, this person has traveled halfway across the world. Probably it's because of something important, you know? and it helps you to get on TV, it helps you to, you know. So there's a lot of utility there. And the other thing Father Marx saw was that it was incredibly useful to have enemies, traditional enemies, bring the pro-life message. So we have a doctor in Croatia who doesn't spend that much time in Croatia. He goes to Serbia. And the Croats and the Serbs have had a very difficult history, a lot of conflict, and even very recently the Civil War. And to have a Croatian doctor speak to a Serbian audience and say, I'm a Croatian doctor, I love your Serbian babies. Don't kill your Serbian babies. The Croats are telling us they love our babies, and we don't love our own. Yeah? And we have Polish, HLI Poland, goes frequently to Russia, and the Poles and the Russians have also had their conflicts. And the same thing, you know, we love your Russian babies, and vice versa, you know. But it's very beautiful, it's very Catholic, very Christian, very universal, you know. You love your enemies, and you want what's good for them. You pray for them. We pray for the conversion. We don't pray for the elimination of the abortionists, of the pro-aborts. We pray for their conversion. And when they do convert, it's incredible. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, you know, Dr. Nathanson, you know, he was the leader, one of the top leaders of the pro-abortion movement, the legalized abortion in America. He personally committed thousands of abortions. He was... you know, at the epicenter, if you will, of the culture of death. He killed by abortion his own child. I mean, you don't get any deeper in the culture of death than that. And even that lost soul was not so lost that he couldn't be pulled out, that he couldn't be converted, that he was baptized. He became a strong, strong pro-lifer. He made those incredible films. You know, most of us have seen The Silent Scream, you know, or The Eclipse of Reason. But he saved so many lives, and it was because the pro-lifers did not hate him. They loved him. They wanted him to come out into the light, and they managed to pull him in. And just recently, Norma McCorvey, who was Jane Roe in the Roe v. Wade, the decision of the U.S. Supreme Court that legalized, just recently she passed away. And she had not only converted to being pro-life, she converted to being Christian, to being Catholic. She spent the last decades of her life fighting for the cause of life, you know, joyfully. And she was a very wounded woman. I met Norma McCorvey a number of times, and she had a very bad background. She'd had, you know, all kinds of problems in her life and addictions and everything else. But she was pulled out of that culture of death into the culture of life by the joy and the love of these pro-lifers. She was actually working as an abortion clinic escort. When she was confronted by pro-lifers who were praying outside of that abortion center. And the reason she had contact with them mainly was that she was smoking cigarettes. And she wasn't allowed to do so inside. And so she started having conversations with the pro-lifers, and they just, you know, she compared the two sides. It was incredible. And she became a pro-lifer. I was in Austria a few years ago, and HLI Austria does these pro-life processions. And so they start with a mass, and they have adoration, and then they do a procession, and they pray the rosary to the abortion center. And one of the abortion centers they go to is on Fleischmarktstraße. And if you know German, that means meat market street. So the abortion is on the meat market street. And not only that, in Vienna, it's in the old Jewish ghetto. So the section of Vienna that was emptied out during the Second World War, where all the inhabitants were killed, at the meat market street is where the Murray Stopes International Clinic is, and they continue the work of killing babies. It's truly remarkable. But so we went to this place, and we were praying the rosary, we were singing hymns, and it was very peaceful. People were generally well-dressed, you know, looking. And there was, you know, police escort. It was a legal permit march, you know, et cetera. But we arrive in front of the abortion center, and there is literally the gates of hell in front of that center. The gates of hell. I mean, people with purple and orange and things coming out of their faces, you know, all kinds of piercings and I don't know what else. And they were gesticulating and screaming and obscenity and everything else. And they were on one side of a barrier, you know, and the police were between us and them, thank God, you know. And we're praying a rosary, you know, etc. And then we had a time of a little bit witnessing afterwards. And there was a man who came up and said, you know, I'm here with you today with the pro-lifers. Last year, I was on the other side of that barricade. And I looked to my right, and I looked to my left, and I was like, what side am I on? You know, I mean, these people are nuts. They're crazy. They're not attractive, love-filled people. And on the other side, there's some very normal-looking people, you know, very loving people. And I think I belong on the other side of this fence. And so we do. I mean, just by our witness, we can show which is the right side, you know, and we can draw people out of that into us. So, why do pro-lifers focus on abortion? Now, I've spoken all over the world, and sometimes the objection is brought to me, you know, the other side calls us anti-abortion, but we don't call ourselves anti-abortion. We call ourselves pro-life. So they're like, well, you know, you can defend life in many, many different ways. And that's absolutely true. So why does the pro-life movement speak about abortion so much, talk about abortion so much? And it's a fair question. So how many of you know how many people died of abortion last year globally? Rough statistics. So that's a quiz time. Yes?
50-60 million.
Very good. So, we're always estimating, right? Estimates, because we don't know, half the world does not have legal abortion. People don't realize this, right? But most of Africa, most of Latin America, most of the Middle East, large parts of Asia, parts of Europe, interestingly, 7 countries in Europe don't have abortion. And we're talking about microstates, right? So there's the Principality of Liechtenstein. There's the Principality of Monaco. There's the Republic of San Marino. There's the Holy See, the Vatican City State. There's Poland. There's Ireland. All these little tiny places kind of resisting abortion on demand. But abortion nonetheless happens all over the world, and in their millions. So the best estimates out there, 40 to 50 million abortions a year. Now, according to the World Health Organization, what is the leading cause of death? Best guess. Not World Health Organization, according to them.
Heart disease,
exactly right. So 7.4 million deaths on an average year globally of heart disease. So heart attacks, different heart failures, etc. And that's the leading cause of death if you don't count abortion. So 40, 50 million, 7.4 million is the next leading cause of death. And in the United States, there are about 600,000 deaths a year of heart disease, over a million abortions. Now, there used to be 1.4 million abortions, almost 1.5 million abortions in the United States. It's been reduced by a third, right? There are now about a million abortions a year, and every year there are fewer and fewer and fewer abortions in the United States because the abortion centers are closing, because the pro-life movement has become so dynamic and culturally changed people that even though it's legal, people are not turning to it in the same numbers. Even though the population is growing, the numbers of abortions is shrinking because more and more people are identifying as pro-life. In England and Wales, there were 60,000 annual deaths in 2014 of heart disease and 184,000 deaths from abortion. The world mobilized against AIDS, the AIDS pandemic. How many people have died of AIDS since the beginning of the epidemic until now? How many people? Best guess. You know a lot, but about the World Health Organization estimates about 39 million people from the beginning of the pandemic till now have died of AIDS. And that's an incredible tragedy. I mean, the world has mobilized to fight the AIDS pandemic. And rightfully so. 39 million people have died. And yet that's less than 1 year's mortality of abortion. And why isn't there the same mobilization to end abortion? You know, it's worse than the entire AIDS pandemic every single year. And if you multiply it, you know, over a 50-year span, how many people is that, you know, since 1967 have died of abortion? Over 2 billion people are missing because of abortion. I mean, you know, we've got 7.3 billion people on the earth today, but 2 billion of them were not allowed to be born. And so, you know, when they ask me, why do pro-lifers speak about abortion? Because we have never seen anything like this in the history of the world. You have to go back to the 14th century and the Black Plague, the Black Death, took 30% of the population. And that is the only catastrophe in the history of the world that kind of compares to what we're going through right now. 20% of established pregnancies today in the world end in abortion. It's unimaginable. And so why do pro-lifers speak about abortion? Because it is the crisis. It is the thing that is going on in the world, the tragedy that needs to be addressed. And it's the human rights issue of our time. And it's a recent problem. It's only in the last, you know, 50, 60 years that abortion has been this way. So the other thing that I notice, and this is incredible, right? But pro-lifers are expected to solve all the world's problems. You know, you're supposed to be about ending abortion or ending something else, but you should be involved in fighting against drugs. You should be involved in fighting against, you know, this or that disease, et cetera, et cetera. And for some reason, pro-lifers have the responsibility to solve all the world's problems before abortion. For some reason, and it's really unfair. I mean, I've never heard any campaigner for any other issue be criticized. You know, someone is out there to save the whales, and a person comes up and says, "You're doing nothing to save the great apes." You know? What's wrong with you? And it's strange, right? For some reason, when you're campaigning against abortion or against the culture of death, you're also required to solve all the rest of the world's problems. Because basically, they don't want you to focus on abortion. They want you to focus on something else. It's difficult. And the other thing, too, in this issue, there are so many lies, so many myths that have been spread to make it uncomfortable, to make it wrong to fight against abortion. Now, you've probably heard this famous quotation. It was from Mark Twain. And he said, you know, there are lies, there are damned lies, and then there are statistics. And it's true. you can absolutely lie using statistics. You can manipulate them, you can massage them, and all kinds of ways to do it. You know, and I've been giving you tons of statistics, and you should check them. You should look them up, you know. Don't take it on this gospel word just because I said it. But it's important to get to the facts. And there are so many myths that surround abortion. And the other side is a champion. The culture of death, the pro-abortion side, loves to manufacture statistics. So I told you about Dr. Nathanson. When he was the head of NARAL, he and his associates would say, they're trying to legalize abortion in America, they were like, there are 10,000 women who are dying of unsafe, illegal abortions every year. And he knew it was a lie. The other people around him knew it was a lie. The journalists probably knew it was a lie, but they accepted it and printed it, etc. And the true numbers were between about 200 and 250 women dying a year. But they were saying 10,000 because they had to scare people into legalizing abortion, because without legal abortion, women are dying in their thousands. Now, every death is a tragedy, but they were lying, you know, and scaring people into legalizing abortion. And this has happened everywhere around the world. So I was at different UN conferences. I was at one in the 1990s, and they presented a maternal mortality number of 500,000 women. And it was interesting because there was you could see the evolution of the lie. So they started with 500,000 women die of maternal mortality globally. And then they said 500,000 women die of abortion globally. And then they took the lie just one step too far. They actually broke down the numbers by country. And there was a person there from Venezuela. And she looked up the number that they gave for the women dying of unsafe illegal abortions in Venezuela. And they had the numbers of all of them, all the deaths, all the women who died between the ages of 15 and 45. So women in reproductive age. And there hadn't been that number of deaths in her country. You know, they're talking about 40,000 deaths. There hadn't been that number of deaths in her country of all causes. But they were saying that that was the number of women who died of illegal abortions in Venezuela. They had to legalize abortion. You know. It's incredible how far these lies go. I was in Benin, in West Africa. And there was a doctor there who told me they were doing a study on illegal abortion, and this was a study that was then going to be used to promote the legalization of abortion in Benin. And, you know, abortion is not legal there, the culture is very pro-life. And what they did in this hospital where this doctor was working was every single woman who came to the hospital because she had a miscarriage, they counted her as having had an illegal abortion. Every single miscarriage in the country that went to the hospital, they were counting that as an illegal abortion. And of course, that would create huge numbers of illegal abortions, and of course, a huge need to legalize abortion. And those kinds of lies are just out there, and they're constantly being promoted. So it's important to see, and there are all these different slogans, you know, that are being used, but there's one that I see on bumper stickers sometimes when I'm in the United States. And it says, you know, against abortion, don't have one. So the idea is, you know, live and let live. Everybody can do what they want. And the absurdity of that slogan, right? Against racism, don't have one. You know, against slavery, don't own one. Yeah, I mean, what does this mean? That just because I am not going to do something, that means it's okay for everyone else to do it? You know, something is either right or it's wrong. And this live and let live mentality is kind of a modern myth, right? That we can allow people to do anything that they want. And in fact, it's our duty to allow other people to make as many mistakes as they want. It's absolutely wrong. And we have to have the courage, just the courage to witness, you know, say, no, I disagree. You know, and I want to talk to you about it. I want to discuss it. I want to be loving with you about it. But I'm not going to just let this happen. And just allow other people to make tragic mistakes, you know, and think that somehow I'm being virtuous by living and letting anyone do whatever they want. The other incredible lie, and it's just spread everywhere, pro-choice. I mean, in America, the other side does not use the word abortion. They do not use the word abortion. They just say choice. Choice, choice, choice. Pro-choice. And it's incredible. It's incredible, right? It's like, what are you choosing? You know, I'm pro-choice. You know, tea or coffee. Pick, you know? I'm pro-choice on all kinds of things, right? But I'm not pro-choice, you know, kill or don't kill. Sometimes I will shock people, you know, just for the sake of getting them out of their comfort zone. I'll say, I am in favor of the death penalty. I'm in favor of the death penalty for unborn children. If you can convict that child in a court of law of a capital crime, then go ahead and execute that child. If you cannot, then don't. Right? And people are like, you're for the death penalty, you know? And it wakes them up because they're against the death penalty, but they're for abortion. These children have done nothing wrong. Nothing wrong. And they're being executed. So it's important. It's important to keep this in mind. But the pro-choice problem, we have to fight tooth and nail to inform women about the dangers of abortion. Whenever there's legislation that comes forward, you know, that women have to be informed, have to be told about what the abortion entails, about the development of their child at the time of the abortion, about the possible negative consequences of the abortion, psychological and physical. I mean, how do you make a choice if you don't know what you're choosing, if you don't know the consequences of what you're choosing? And the pro-choice side fights tooth and nail that women not be given a choice, not be given a truly informed choice about what they're choosing when they have an abortion. So how can they be pro-choice if they don't want people to be informed? All right, how about the fight against conscientious objection? You've seen that, right? They want to force doctors, they want to force nurses, force hospitals to perform abortions. So you cannot choose not to perform an abortion if you're a medical doctor. That choice, you don't have that choice. So how are you pro-choice, right? You're against their choice to be pro-life as a medical personnel. How is that pro-choice? And but the worst, the absolute, and it just breaks my heart. Dr. David Reardon went and interviewed women who had abortions. What was the number one reason these women gave for having had an abortion? Number one reason. I felt that I had no choice. 64%. I mean, isn't that incredible? I mean, the abortion campaigners campaign on choice. And yet all of their actions, almost all of their actions are to eliminate choice. Right? No choice in terms of informed consent. No choice in the form of conscientious objection. And the women themselves who are coming to them for these abortions are coming because they feel they have no other choice, and they are not offering other choices. You go to the abortion center, they're not going to tell you about adoption. They're not going to tell you about all the different ways that they could keep the child. They're going to tell them about the abortion and how they should have that choice. So they really don't, they're not pro-choice, they're for one choice. And something else that really irks me is that all these groups talk about being pro-woman, how pro-woman they are, and that, you know, they are women's campaigners. They're doing things to help women. How many of you are aware of sex selection abortion? Raise a hand. Yeah, so we all know about it. And what is sex selection abortion? When you kill a child because they're of the wrong sex. And in practice, around the world, what does that mean? Most of the time, the vast majority of the time, it's a baby girl who is being killed because she is female. It is the greatest crime of sex discrimination in the history of the world. It's an estimate that about 200 million missing girls who have either been aborted before birth or infanticide after birth, so killed because they were girls. And you go to the abortion campaigners, you're like, well, you guys are pro-woman, right? You're trying to defend women. These women are being attacked. They're being killed because they're women. We have to stand together. We can at least agree on this, right? To ban sex selection abortion. And then they reveal who they really are. And they're like, no. No, no, no. The right to abort for any reason, is a woman's sacred right. And therefore, the right to abort a baby girl because she's a girl, to eliminate women, is part of the sacred right to an abortion. And in my book, I mean, they completely forfeit their right to be called pro-women at that point. I mean, there are so many other reasons, but I mean, there it's so, so clear. And you know, we can tell that sex selection abortion is happening all over the world. There's a natural birth ratio between boys and girls. Most of you probably don't know that there are more boys born than girls naturally. Boys tend to die more than girls. Infant mortality for boys is higher than for girls. So it's natural to have about 103 to 105 boys for every 100 girls at birth. And by about age 5, usually there's a parity. There's usually 100 boys for 100 girls because there's more genetic problems, and there's little boys tend to be more fragile than little girls. So, but if you have a sex ratio that is above that, then you can tell that, you know, there's something going on, that we're manipulating the births here. And all over the world, not just in the Far East. I mean, the countries that are the worst offenders, you know, tend to be in the Far East. But we see these problems in Europe, in Greece, in places like Luxembourg, Norway, you know, places that are supposedly very modern and advanced. We see it in the United States in some places. We see it in Latin America, in El Salvador, a country which doesn't even have legal abortion, but the birth rates are slightly skewed. I mean, sex selection abortion is happening all over the world. It's an increasing problem. And because technology is arriving where they can scan, you know, and do the ultrasounds and find out the sex of the child, there's more and more of this sex selection abortion taking place. And it's going to create a terrible world. I mean, right now, you know, they're estimating they're going to be something like 60 million or 80 million Chinese that will not be able to get married because there's literally no women. I was in Taiwan, and there's a big sort of business, if you will, of mail order brides, where they don't have enough women of their age to get married, and so the men kind of contract with the service, and then they'll mail order a bride from Indonesia or from Vietnam or the Philippines, and it's creating all these, you know, social problems, etc. And there's a rise in prostitution, and actually a rise in the abuse of women. In China, one of the big problems today is women being kidnapped, and even baby girls being kidnapped, because people want to assure that they can have a wife for their son, so they're trying to, like, you know, capture a woman for their son. And prostitution and all kinds of incredible things going on. There's in India, there's a problem of people sharing a wife. So you'll have 4 or 5 men that'll share a wife because they can't afford to have a wife. And so they'll just kind of have this situation. Just horrific things going on because of this sex selection abortion. And it's not a new problem, right? The culture of death is not a new problem. I was at a wonderful talk several years ago, over 10 years ago, by the then Archbishop of Malta. And he mentioned the fact, you know, that the oldest medical instruments that archaeologists have discovered, over 2,000 years old, are curettes for performing abortions. Over 2,000 years ago. And the Hippocratic Oath that medical doctors would take, which has now been modified in many, many places, it speaks specifically against abortion and euthanasia. That oath is from the 5th century BC. So in the 5th century BC, there was a problem with doctors doing abortions, doctors doing euthanasias. So it's not a new problem. And I've been you know, to so many countries, and the one thing that is a commonality around the world is that the ancient cultures were all what we would call cultures of death, in the sense that they had human sacrifice. They had situations where human rights were not respected. I was in Carthage, and there's a temple there of Moloch Baal. And you visit, it's called Tophet. And you go visit this place, and the archaeologists have found little urns with the incinerated remains of what they estimate about 10,000 children who were burned to death to the pagan god Moloch in Carthage. And you go everywhere. I was in Mexico City. You know, in Mexico City, they had human sacrifice on an industrial scale. Thousands and thousands of people had their hearts removed as a sacrifice to the pagan gods of the Aztecs. And like this all over the world. I mean, there was a culture of death that really dominated the earth everywhere. And then there was a light. There was a light that came in the darkness. And it was the people of God. It was the Israel, the Hebrews. And in the Bible, you know, there's that incredible story about the Hebrew midwives. So Pharaoh says, you know, the people, the Israelis, the Hebrews, are multiplying too much. The midwives will go and kill the children. So we'll use the medical personnel, culture of death, to kill these children if they're boys. So it's a sex selection, but they're selecting out the boys in this case. So sex selection, infanticide. And the Hebrew midwives refused. And something else that struck me is over the centuries, the people of Israel were known for having two strange things about them. So the first strange thing is that they only had one God. And monotheism just didn't exist. Everywhere, all over the earth, you know, it was many gods. Polytheism was the norm, the universal norm. But the people of Israel only had one God. And they were known all over the Mediterranean as the people who did not abort. The Jews did not abort their children. But everybody else did. You know, an infanticide, etc. And then with Christianity, with the advent of the Christians, the culture of death just retreated and retreated, and abortion disappeared. And contraception disappeared, interestingly. The whole transformation of especially Europe through Christianity was a turning away from the culture of death to a culture of life. And that culture spread all over the world. And to the point where, at the beginning of the 20th century, there was not a country on earth that legalized abortion. Not a country on earth. So what was the first country to legalize abortion? Soviet Union. Yes, and right. 1920. And when Vladimir Lenin said he wanted to create his new, you know, communist paradise, he said he had to destroy the church, he had to destroy the family, as institutions that would block the advent of this Marxist ideal. And in order to destroy the family, divorce and abortion. So the Marxists, the communists, initiated legalized abortion in the world, in the 20th century. And who came very closely after them, the next country to legalize abortion? Yeah, so first the Weimar Republic. Already the Weimar Republic legalized abortion for several reasons. And then the Nazis spread this, but not only did they spread it, so they tainted it with their own ideology, right? So you weren't supposed to have an abortion if you were Aryan, but you were supposed to have an abortion if you were anybody else. And there was actually a very interesting article that I read. It was in the Israeli medical, let's see, what was the exact name of it? Israeli Medical Journal. And it was Israeli Medical Association Journal entitled Doctors, Pregnancy, Childbirth and Abortion During the Third Reich. And this Israeli author describes how the Nazis used abortion and specifically sterilization as means of spreading their ideology and getting rid of the people they didn't like. They also initiated euthanasia and spread that very much. But if we look at the origin, right, the beginning of the pro-choice revolution, the beginning of abortion in the modern world, it's the two most despicable ideologies that everybody rejects. That's the origin of our present state of legalized abortion in so many countries. And then who picked up, after the Second World War, who picked up the ball, if you will, to carry abortion further? The radical feminists. And particularly Margaret Sanger, Murray Stopes, And what do they have in common? Both Margaret Sanger and Murray Stopes. Racist eugenicist mentality, right? They wanted more from the fit and less from the unfit. And according to them, the unfit tended to be the lower class, anything that wasn't sort of Anglo-Saxon, Nordic races, anybody who was from a kind of a religious minority they didn't like. They didn't really like any religion, but they particularly disliked Catholicism or Islam or anything like that. And they pursued this, you know, ideology of legalizing abortion as a woman's right, but with a strong eugenicist undercurrent, right? Planned Parenthood Federation around the world still functions with that idea. They work especially in the third world, in the developing countries, to promote their ideology, and they push it, and in the United States, they push abortion particularly among racial minorities. So in the United States, the black population is about 11% of the U.S. population. 36% of the abortions in America are on African-American women. 36%, so you're three times more likely to die from abortion if you're of African-American heritage in America than if you're of European heritage. In England and Wales, in 2014, 8% of women having abortions were black or black British, when they represent 3.3% of the total population. So more than twice as many abortions in the UK from people of African heritage. And this is, these are all the skeletons that are in the closet, you know, of the abortion movement. They are a group that is pushing a toxic ideology, and trying to make themselves seem modern, compassionate, pro-woman, when none of that applies, and trying to make themselves seem pro-choice when none of that applies. So I'll go back to my original statement at the beginning of this. You know, if you are not involved in the pro-life movement, if you are not doing everything you can to fight this crisis, you've missed the boat. You are not involved in the human rights campaign of our generation. It is the single most important cause today. And we have to get involved. I mean, I'm a historian in background. And, you know, and I'm thinking, if I was in the 19th century in Britain, and I wasn't helping William Wilberforce, I'd be kicking myself, you know? I'd be like, wow, you know, I missed the boat on that. Fighting the slave trade. That was the issue right then. Hey, every period in history has an issue, a dominant problem that we have to deal with. You know, in the Second World War, if you weren't fighting against totalitarianism, what were you doing? You know, if you're sitting on the sidelines. There is always a cause. There is something so important, and we have to get involved. And I love a quotation from St. Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And she said this in 1994 to then President Bill Clinton. I feel the greatest destroyer of peace today is abortion, because it is a war against the child. A direct killing of the innocent child, murder by the mother herself. And if we accept that a mother can kill her own child, how can we tell other people not to kill one another? And it's so true. I mean, if the bond between a parent and a child, and particularly between the mother and her child, if that is not sacred, if that bond doesn't mean that you should be free from murder, free from being killed, what is a neighbor? What is a foreigner? I mean, what kind of tie do I have to that other person to make me not want to kill them, you know, if I have some reason to kill them, if there's some dispute. So she was famous, you know, as saying that to her, the fruit of the culture of death, the fruit of abortion, was war. Because we're allowing people to be killed who have a sacred tie. And then how can we tell anybody else not to kill anybody else? I mean, there's just no rational foundation there. And I think it shows the corrosive effect on society. I'm always struck by the school shootings. People go into schools and start randomly killing children, you know, and massacring children. And the thing that strikes me the most is that every single time this happens, it happens in a country with legalized abortion. It doesn't happen in countries where abortion is not legal. And so to me, it just strikes me, right? I mean, we have killed our own children in these countries. Legally said it's okay to kill your own children. And some people, you know, they devalue human life so much that they go out and they just randomly kill people in large numbers because they have personal problems, you know. And killing people is an acceptable activity in this society to some extent. It's a terrible, terrible thing. Now, globally, in 2015, 117 out of 224 countries around the world, nations and territories, you know, there's always a question, what's a real country and what's not? Is Taiwan a country? Okay, but anyway, out of 224 nations, territories, 117 have total fertility rates below 2.1. So less than two children per family, per woman. So by definition, those societies over time are disappearing. They don't have enough children to literally replace their populations. And globally, a majority of the population on Earth live in countries, the majority of the Earth, countries that do not have enough children just to replace themselves. And most of this is because of abortion. The global fertility rate today is 2.36 children. Global. You count every country together, everything together, 2.36, and dropping. It's been dropping since 1950, the fertility rate, global fertility rate. And it's so bad, right, that demographers tell us that we will probably fall globally below fertility rate, below 2.1, in about 8 years, 2025. And world population will probably begin to decline, peak and then decline, starting in 2055. And so we're literally, for the first time in history, except for, you know, the Black Death, seeing global population start to decline again because people are refusing to have children. And there's kind of a global acceptance of the culture of death. But what is interesting from a pro-life perspective is who are having children. Pro-lifers or people who are in favor of abortion, culture of life, culture of death. In the United States, they did a census in 2000. Every 10 years, they do a census. In the 2000 census, one of the demographers just kind of looked at some statistics, and they found that in Seattle, Washington, the Pacific Northwest, the average household had 45% more dogs than children. So people had pets, large numbers of pets, but very few children. Of course, that's a very liberal area. When you went to more conservative areas, they had more children than pets. When you looked at people who went to church, 47% of people who attended church weekly said their ideal family size was three or more children. So people who go to church have more children. By contrast, 27% of those who seldom attend church wanted to have three or more children. And we've seen that all around the United States, and I think all around the world. People of faith, and all kinds of faith, you know, whether it's Christianity or another faith, they tend to be more fertile. They tend to have more children, they have more families. And in a certain sense, I mean, it's terrible to say, but the culture of death literally eats its own children. You know, they either refuse to have children or they abort their own children. But, you know, most of the big feminist campaigners or the, you know, LGBT and fill in all the rest of the alphabet have so few children that it's kind of laughable, you know, in terms of 1 point or 0 point, you know, something, number of children on average. So they are literally dying. They're disappearing. But we as pro-lifers, you know, so having more children obviously going to win in the end, but we have to have compassion. We have to have mercy. We have to go out and convert these people. We don't have to just wait for them to disappear on their own. We have to go out and bring them back in the light, save them, pull them back from the abyss. Here's a challenge for all of us. 83% of women who had an abortion, who went through an abortion, 83% in one study said if one person had asked me, had told me not to go through with it, I probably would not have had that abortion. But there was not one person who told them, no, do something else. You can't do that. No, absolutely, we'll help you. There are other solutions, et cetera, et cetera. Among their family, among their friends, among the medical profession, everybody, their co-workers, nobody stood for life. And just one person could have saved that life. I mean, the witness is so incredible. And I'll finish with this story. We had a very good family friend now. We met her when I was growing up as a teenager, one of my sisters and I. And Christina had grown up in a very secular environment, etc. And, you know, she never thought much about it, but she was sure abortion was okay, you know. And she said as much, and she thought feminism was great, you know, etc. And in favor of women and women's rights and all that kind of thing. And she told us as much, and we said, no, you don't know. I mean, abortion is horrible. Abortion is terrible. I mean, you have to study this. This is, you can't be in favor of abortion. And we talked to her, et cetera, and she studied on her own, and she became convinced. She became convinced, and she became a pro-lifer. And when she graduated high school, she went to university. She attends the university, she arrives, and she looks for the Pro-Life Student Association. And there isn't one. So she's like, well, I'm going to go found it then. So she starts up, you know, does the paperwork, etc. And they have a little session for entering students, freshmen, first year, I think freshers in the UK, yeah. British English. She had a little table, and she had, you know, Pro-Life Student Association, some pamphlets she got from a local pro-life group, etc., some information. She stood at this table, she had a sign-up sheet. People signed up, it was great, everything was nice, she started the pro-life club, everything was good, but nothing dramatic happened. The second year, she was there again, she was at the table, a young lady walks up and says, thank you. And she says, oh, have we met? No, but I came last year, I saw your materials, and she said, I was pregnant, and I was going to have an abortion. And I saw your materials. And then she pulled out a picture. And she said, her name is Bianca. And she's alive today because you were here. And by standing at a table with a little bit of information, she had saved a human life. Can you imagine any activity, anything that you could do? You know, you could spend your entire life as a fireman. Your entire life, you know, in so many different processions and not save a human life. And by standing in front of a little table with a little bit of information, you can save a human life. By standing in front of an abortion center, you can save a precious human life. It's an incredible opportunity. My mother started a crisis counseling center in Corpus Christi, and most of the counselors who were helping were housewives, were home, stay-at-home mothers, who offered, volunteered their time to do this pro-life counseling. And the thing that my mother found most extraordinary was not that they saved lives, because they saved many lives, but the incredible self-esteem of these homemakers, of these stay-at-home mothers who said, wow, I am saving human lives. I mean, I'm doing something incredible here with my volunteer for 2 hours a week, you know? And she found, you know, that they were so empowered by the good that they were able to do. And this is the kind of thing that the pro-life movement does for us, right? It's a terrible, hard, we're going to be criticized, people are going to dislike us, everything else, but incredible rewards. Congressman Henry Hyde in the United States was such a strong pro-lifer. He ended his life saying, look, as a pro-lifer, when you die and you come up in front of eternal judgment, you come up before the throne of God, there will be a crowd of children who will be there saying, let this person in. They did so much for me, you know? And you're basically building your treasure in heaven as part of it. There won't be that many rewards on earth. I can't promise you too many rewards on earth. But I think in heaven, you can pretty be assured that there will be rewards. People will be thankful for the work we do. So thank you very much.
Pro-Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.